All right, we start out Friday evening. It's cleared up in California. Spring is here, breezy but beautiful. And I'm taping because I have a lot to say. A lot happens. A lot takes place in my day, to say the least. And a lot took place today, of course. I don't even know how to talk about it, but we will give it a try here. First, let's settle down. Now, the first thing is every time I turn to the Holy Spirit, I say, Holy Spirit, the sun is blasting me right now, so that's why my face is like this. Holy Spirit, okay. I free my mind, relax my mind, release my thoughts, let them go. Holy Spirit, what do you have for me? You know what the Holy Spirit always does? Always does. And it's like clockwork, and that's why I tend to not turn to the Holy Spirit, because it brings up asteroids hitting the world. Always. And I say, Holy Spirit, you've already told me this 1,000 times and 1,000 more. Well, what the heck are we supposed to do about it? You know, I don't care if asteroids hit. If we don't have any recourse, then this is just spreading panic, you know? So, once again, powerful, powerful, powerful experiences today, reinforcing the notion of this Earth getting hit by rocks, incoming rocks from space. Because I turned to the Holy Spirit. So, just let that be whatever, you know, as it is. Let's shift over to something else. The Christian mission throughout history, I'll break it down for you very simply. Pagan times, barbaric times, were what? Many gods. Gods everywhere, so many different gods, and many sacrifices to those many gods. Old Testament time, what was that? Monotheism, which is many sacrifices going on, but one God. Okay? So instead of many gods, many sacrifices, you have one God, many sacrifices. Then Jesus Christ came along, sacrifice on the cross. Here you had one God and one sacrifice. Okay? So you see the trend. Many gods, many sacrifices. One God, many sacrifices. One God, one sacrifice. Then Jesus returned with A Course in Miracles, saying, one God, no sacrifice. No sacrifice. And then Apex Yoga comes along and gives us skillful means to experience the peace of God, where we realize it was all a dream. It was all a dream. Nothing ever happened. There's never been any time, space, process, or form. Never been any sacrifices. Nothing's ever happened. It's all been spontaneous in the now all along. So this is how it progresses. Many gods, many sacrifices. One God, many sacrifices. One God, one sacrifice. One God, no sacrifice. Abidance as the peace of God. So we're focused on that last part now, right? Because at least I've certainly been through all those other parts of it. And now I'm at the part, the Apex Yogin part, Apex Wow Yogin, which gives really, really clear and compelling, skillful practice out of how do we get to the peace of God. And after the peace of God, there's nothing you can say at all about the experiencing. Nothing that can be said. So, peace of God is the last stage that we can even talk about or say anything about. Even then, it gets very abstract. And we should understand that. We're going to much, you know, much, much more abstract expression. So, you have that. You have that my knee just blew up on me because I tried running. I thought I was supposed to get in better shape running. And I thought my knee is just, you know, worse than it's ever been. And I said, uh-oh, this ruins all my plans. This is horrible. Ouch. It still is very painful there. But, wonder of wonders, it doesn't affect my golf swing. Doesn't I don't have any pain. I said, huh, how's that possible? I don't know. Now, I walked into this pizza place a couple of days ago, last Sunday actually, and 5 days ago. No, it wasn't Sunday. It was last, like, Monday or Tuesday. I was picking up to go an order to go. That's right. And so I was waiting for the order to be finished. And I said, what should I do? I'm standing around waiting. I don't know. And then suddenly I saw this, there's this television, big screen television, and it had this golf on. And I said, huh, maybe I should just check the golf out while I'm waiting. And then I suddenly realized that's Tiger Woods. And I said, wait a minute. He's very thin. That's a young Tiger Woods. That's the Masters. I said, I wonder if they're replaying the 97 Masters. And indeed they were. The highlights from the 97 Masters was on this. And so I said, look, wow. So I said, let me watch this. I'm watching Tiger Woods when he was young. Young and thin and hit the heck out of the ball. And I watched him hit his iron shot. I watched him hit and I said, hey, wait a minute. That's the same setup I have. I said, that's how I'm practicing my irons. I don't hit balls. I just swing the club. But that's the same. Everything's the same. I said, my gosh, I'm onto something. Because I didn't know Tiger swung that like that. That's, wow. So that kind of fired me up. And I said, hey, you know what? Why did I happen to just, I mean, I rarely do that. It was like a totally rare thing that I did. And there's Tiger Woods, 97 Masters, and showcasing his swing with his irons, and it's reinforcing exactly how I'm swinging him now. How do you, you know, so this is like a positive sort of circumstance that shows you somehow you're being guided. You're being guided. I'm wearing my Spieth shirt. I wish I could putt like Jordan Spieth. Maybe I can. Of course, he putts cross-handed and doesn't look at the ball. He looks at the hole on shorter putts. I don't know if I can do that, but I'd like to make him like he does. Anyway, so today I tried swinging the full club, like a 3-wood and a driver, and I tried this stance with I have with the irons with those clubs, and I said, my gosh. Choke up on the club, get the ball close to you, stand upright, narrow stance with your feet, balls of your feet, narrow stance, and boy, did I have great speed, just whipping it through. Keep in mind that he used like a driver, is like 38 inches or something, very short driver, so he could stand close to the ball. And with the shorter driver, it seems like you could actually swing it faster. I say, hey, let me try this. So getting some tips from Tiger is very cool, and picking up on that and seeing that I can do it. Of course, he's limping along on his knees too, so commonality there. He won the U.S. Open at Riviera on one leg, basically. And one leg, he could hardly walk. And he still won it in a playoff, 18-hole playoff. Went 5 rounds on that bad leg. Amazing. So there's that, which is, I said, great. And then there's everything else. Facebook. I put everyone back, checked for notifications. So I'm getting notifications from 244 people, friends. And yeah, like, you know, 100 notifications, 100 notifications. 100. It's like, serial posters, you know, in there, right? It's just they don't stop. Suddenly, bing, 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 you know, the 50 posts like that, and there's a bunch of serial posters. And I put up a post, and you know, I get one response. That's about the most response I get. One, sometimes two. I said, what am I spending all my time? I was thinking of doing this intricate graphic for the Christian mission, which we went over, which is, of course, pre-Old Testament times, many gods, many sacrifices to many gods. The Old Testament times, one God, many sacrifices to that God. Jesus' time, sacrifice, was to bring all those sacrifices in just one sacrifice. So he had one God then and one sacrifice to that God. And then the next stage was Jesus with A Course in Miracles, which is one God and no sacrifices to that God. And then the next step is to how to abide in the peace of God. How to abide, which is to use the wow practice, which pre-selects one evaluation to be applied to everything that you experience. So we say wow is the evaluation we're going to use. And when we already know exactly what our evaluation is going to be, this is amazing, has amazing effect on us, that we're no longer scared of the peace of God, because we say, well, I know what my evaluation is going to be. It's going to be wow. There's no doubt about it. I've already committed and decided upon that. So it's a way of committing. It's a commitment. Apex, wow, yoga, and commitment is even beyond A Course in Miracles. It's the next step. Just one evaluation covers all possible evaluations, both past and future. Okay, you already have settled on, for the peace of God, what your evaluation is going to be. Or anything that arises, any experiencing that could ever arise in conditioned existence, as we are imagining it, pretending it, you've decided that you're just going to have one reaction to everything, which is wow. And when you do this, it's like a miracle. Fear seems to start leaving you very quickly. And you feel like, wow, I don't need all that mental chatter anymore, do I? I don't need it anymore. So this is really skillful means we have here. And it's just a simple commitment is all it takes. Sounds simple, doesn't it? Yeah, but making the commitment, you know, is the jittery part. And that's why we work at this. We work at this. So Facebook, I don't know what I'm going to do. It's just nuts. It's just Facebook is really a nutty place. I mean, there are some good posters. I'm trying to keep them around. There's a few really good posters that, you know, they post some very profound stuff. But it's really not a place where many people actually dialogue with one another or exchange ideas. It's like post. And if you say something, you know, and a lot of times nobody responds, and it's like a minimalist sort of thing in a lot of ways. But, you know, for me, I'd like it to be like a forum where, you know, we can share back and forth, and occasionally that takes place. People are willing to write a little bit. It's pretty rare, actually. They throw some dog sticker at you, which is another thing we're talking about. I could draw cartoons. I could be a really good cartoonist if I wanted to waste my time, but who's going to watch? Nobody on Facebook. A post on Facebook, you get zero views. You know? So why waste time right now? It's a time. Well, this one of my friends posted this video, and it was this man playing violin on a subway. And then it was this slideshow, and it said, this violinist came and played in the subway. And it was during rush hour or something. And virtually everyone just passed him by. And someone just threw a dollar and then just kept on walking and stuff. The only one to stop and listen for a little bit was a little boy. But his mom grabbed him and said, come on, we're late. We got to go. And so then he ultimately, after like 45 minutes, he finished his playing and left. And virtually everyone had just ignored him and passed him by. Well, it turns out he's one of the greatest violinists in the world. He was playing some of the greatest violin music ever there in the subway. And this is just to show what's going on with this world. And then I said, well, you know, if Jesus was there blessing everyone, there'd be even fewer people stop and pay any attention. Almost virtually nobody would stop and pay attention. Which is, you know, what a commentary on this world. So the Holy Spirit is saying, keeps relentlessly, my whole life, the world's going to be hit by rocks from space. And it's going to cause, you know, basically the tribulation. We know the tribulation starts with the astronomical setup of in Virgo, of the Virgin, with Jupiter in her in her womb area and the crown with what was it, 12 stars or how many stars? I can't remember. But you have all the stars, eight, and then three planets. Maybe it's 11 stars or something like that. The moon on her shoulder, clothed with the moon, or the sun. The sun, clothed with the sun on her shoulder, and the moon at her feet. That's coming up September 23rd, first time in 7,000 years that this configuration has been in place. And just by coincidence, September is this window which these very genius astronomers and those who somehow figure this out, it's quite extraordinary. But there are those who specialize in this kind of stuff. It's a window, very, very dangerous window for the Earth to get hit by space rocks. So then the Bible, it says, then the dragon will show up, and the dragon, this horrible dragon, will cast a third of the stars down from the sky at this time. And so there's all this, revelation stuff going on. And that would probably mean a shower of stuff from the sky, just massive meteorite shower or something, seeming like the stars are coming down from being cast down from the sky as they, flame overhead. This is how the ancients would depict it. They thought stars were pinholes in some dark covering that covers the earth, and pinholes through which heaven could be seen, that the light of stars were actually just pinholes in this covering that were letting in some light from heavens. That's how they viewed it. So the idea of casting these stars down from the sky would and the dragon, this great dragon, would be the either this complex, you call it Nibiru complex, you call it the dwarf star complex, that it's gone throughout history. It's come through the solar system many times. And it's got this iron oxide reddish tint to it, and has a long tail, and it symbolize dragon is what sim is how it's symbolized, this terrible dragon. And we're told that the ocean and rivers, the waters, bodies of water of the world will turn to blood when this great dragon passes by, which means all the dust from this will turn the get into the water, the iron oxide dust. So you have these biblical warnings about tribulation, and then you have also the collapse of the church, of civilization, and we're already there. I saw something that the Pope, another post, and I have not paid any attention to Cardinal Bernard, what's his name, Bernardino or something, Bernardo, because I excommunicated him before Jesus returned. I said this guy has to be excommunicated. So, with the authority I have as one of G as an apostle of Jesus, in connection with the Dharma kings, I excommunicated him. So that's it. You don't see any Christians and Catholics anymore. And because the church age ended in May 1st, 215, because Jesus returned to this world, so the papacy is finished. It's over. He's not a pope. He's just a pretender. There's no more pope speaking for Christendom. It's Jesus has returned, and he's speaking directly to our spirit. And what he said was just so amazingly bizarre. I don't want to criticize him or, however you take his words, but I just couldn't believe what I heard. I really could not believe it. I said, thank God he's not the Pope anymore. Yeah, the church age is over, to say the least. And he's just, throwing dirt on the grave, that is for sure. So, boy, I haven't heard. I don't pay any attention to the news anymore. I just happened to, just out of the blue, I just started to look up one of my friend's timelines, which I rarely do, because the stuff that's on it. And here was this news article and the quotes of what the Pope was saying. I said, "You gotta be kidding! That's some kind of joke? Are you kidding me?" Wow. I said, well, the end times are coming for sure. And it's last call time in the world, last call, where the doubters, the habit of doubt which is the habit, for eons and eons we have been trying to automate doubt. Okay, so when you look at this world and bodies, nature and stuff, what is it actually? It's an attempt to automate doubt. Okay, automate it. So we say it's automatic. We say the mind isn't doing it. It's happening automatically. All we're doing is dreaming a dream of automation. It's still the mind doing it every instant. But you can see the massive care and focus we have had for eons on trying to automate doubt, which is this world and the universe is just that, our attempt to automate doubt. So you have this this pretending to fixate the mind, which we call lives. You know, lives is just this attempt to automate doubt. All this automated doubt, moving images we call trees and sky and mountains and homes and cars and people and animals and flowers and nature, everything that we're perceiving, just as just we call that life. We think that's life. It has nothing to do with life. We say we had a life. You mean we're imagining some process, some scheme, some software, like scheme of progress, software program of automating doubt. Like, yeah, this body is my latest try at automating doubt. Now look at all these attempts to automate doubt in the form of what we call trees. Yeah, like that. That's all that this place is. Trying to make doubt automatic. Inevitable. Happens no matter what the mind wants. It's going to happen automatically anyway. That's what we're trying to do. And you know, time, space, process, and form, it's necessary to believe in that in order to believe that we can automate doubt. But realize that we can't automate doubt. And certainty is still completely certain. There's nothing we can do about it. Doubt is just an attempt to deny certainty. So it's just meaningless. And so we don't really need to believe in time, space, process, or form and believe that there's lives, you know, that this constitutes life. What is life? It's ridiculous, actually. Life is freedom, the freedom of mind, which is always present. That's the one life. There's just one life. They're not all these separate lives. These are not lives at all. These are just silly games of imagination, trying to automate, make doubt automatic. Fixate the mind, trying to fixate the mind. Like we're doubting that the mind is free. Because here's evidence. Look at this fixation we call life. It's just a dream. How fixated are figures in a dream? How fixated are they? Are they fixated? I mean, haven't we had dreams where we think there's figures doing stuff and suddenly, wait a minute, you know, like what happened? They just disappeared and something else popped up. You know, where's the fixation in a dream? There isn't any. There isn't any fixation. It's all completely fluid at each moment. Even though we can choose, keep choosing something the same, it's still completely fluid. Just like this, our experiencing world, the world, everything's totally fluid, actually. And I wonder if that dream I had in the living room, the roof starting to leak all everywhere, water's pouring through everywhere. I wonder if that wasn't that my mind is starting to see fluidity everywhere. I wonder if that's possible. Maybe I'll have to change the way I view dreams of water. But for me, it was a warning to stop view watching surfing. It was consuming me. It's waiting for the wave. Shall we run the event? You know, and it's very intense because the guys are waiting out there for waves. They're so dependent on nature for their scores. You know, and the heats are running down, and one guy needs a wave. So he needs a 6.12 to win the heat. And the guys are both out there, and one of them has priority, and they're waiting, and there's no waves. And the clock is ticking, ticking, ticking. And you say, come on, wave, hurry up. You know, you frantically say, whoa, aren't there any waves coming? And then, you know, Suddenly, like, something finally shapes up. You look at the clock, there's 11 seconds. I got to take off. And so they take off, you know, right at the horn or something. Finally, a wave comes, and then they have to ride it really, really good. Any mistake, you know, they're going to lose. And you just, you're like going, like, oh, my gosh, oh, my gosh. It's a nerve-wracking thing to watch surfing contests. I don't know anything that's so nerve-wracking. It's not like any other sporting contest because you can get skunked. Because the waves go flat on you. You never know what's going to come as far as the waves. It's so dependent on what kind of waves show up and when. And man, you're just at the mercy, seemingly. Although they say that Kelly Slater somehow is able to generate these waves to come to him. Of course, he's the guy who created the wave pool. So he's really into generating waves. And they say he was able to generate with his mind, generate good waves for himself and win. You know, well, probably. The wave only seemed to do what he wanted it to do. So there's that. I don't know what to do with Facebook. I mean, really. Just. I mean, theoretically, it's a great platform. It's the people that are using it that are on their smartphones. Everybody's on their smartphone. Ding, 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 ding. You know, and, oh, I'll take a call. Ding, ding, ding. Where is the contemplation? You know, it's, of course, it's not there. So is it helping us, or is it helping us be those people on the subway that pass that virtuoso by? You know, is that where it's leading us? And are we being led to spiritual realization, or are we being led to those people in the subway who would pass Jesus by? Right? Isn't this a pertinent question to ask? Yeah. So I say it's better to be in a place that's very slow-paced, relaxed, slow-paced, everything slowed down. Don't worry about your, you know, smartphone, or very few diversions or anything, and just drop your pace of life way down slow. And so you're driving along in your golf cart, you see a beautiful flower. You know what I do? I stop. I say, I just feel like stopping right now. And I forget all about golf. I just say, I just love just being here right now. This is where I want to be right now. And I'm not taking a picture or making an image. I'm just part of this totality. Just part of the totality. It's so wonderful, and I miss that. I want to get back to it. I live it. My life is too frantic now, and it isn't right. And I'm complaining to the Dharma King ceaselessly. I say, "What in the heck is going on?" Well, they would say, you know, inducement, right? Incentives. I say, we want you to work really, really hard so you can get back to that. And I'd say, well, isn't it better just to get back to it and work really hard at staying with it? So we have this argument, kind of like I say, you know, don't tell me what not to do. Tell me what to do. Don't put me in a place I shouldn't be and say, yeah, this is bad, this is bad, this is bad. Put me in a place that's good for me. And so this is kind of an area I kind of just scratch my head a little bit. Because it's better to tell someone what to do. Because if they don't know what to do, they're going to endlessly do wrong stuff. And you can just point out, that's wrong, that's wrong, that's wrong, that's wrong, that's wrong. How about just tell me what's right, and I'll do that. And then we won't have to waste all this time pointing out what's wrong. Easy. But... you know, it's got to be my fault somehow. I'm tired of this, really. It's just, we need to drop out of the world. You know, practice dropping out of the world. So the Holy Spirit keeps hammering away that disaster's coming. Okay, I said, what do we do? Well, Holy Spirit said, practice the wow practice. Using your precognition. I used to have virtually flawless precognition. And I found out that people hate certainty in this world. They're doubt addicts here. And that's deep, 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 deep habits of this for eons. So superficially, people can be very nice, but deep down, they're totally psychotic. I mean, they believe in time, space, process, and form, which is crazy. They believe the mind isn't free, which is crazy. And they have these severe, deep, deep habits of doubt. So here I am, come and say, hey, I'm sure this is going to happen. And they go like, you can't be sure of anything that something's going to happen. That's impossible. And then what happened, I said, see, I can do it. With it. And like, that's not right. Something wrong with that. I really doubt we can do it again. And I do it again. And I said, then they got even more upset. I said, well, you did it, but I really doubt we can do that again. In other words, they're saying, it's just luck. It's just luck. So I did it so many times, I realized it wasn't luck. And then they got really upset. So I thought that precognition was a gift to help the world out, but it turned out just to be a nightmare to cause ostracism for them. People hate certainty. It scares them to death. They'd rather die than have certainty. The certainty they want is death, actually. That's the only certainty they want, because that seems to fixate, they believe it fixates the mind. The identification with the body is so that we can believe that death is effective in fixating the mind. If we give up trying to fixate the mind, one, we don't need death at all, and two, we don't need to identify with the body at all. There's no more need. We lose interest in it. So, there's no use to that at all. So it's a purpose-driven path is the best path. What's the purpose to all this stuff? Find out what the purpose is. Then when you see that, you say, it's so easy, it's ridiculous. You don't have to go through all these mental cogitations and esoteric practices and everything, but you just see it so clear and obvious, you just, okay, no interest in that. And that's the end of that, you know, that's it. Purpose-driven path. Discover what the purpose of all this nonsense is. Death and decay. You know, what's the purpose? Bodies, all this stuff. Just, we think that, if we just identify with the body, we made brains, so we could identify with them, claim that the mind was really the brain. So we tried to make something that we could plausibly identify with them and believe was the mind. You know, tried to represent the mind. How do you represent freedom? We've been trying to represent freedom, and so we could then identify it and then kill it, have it stop functioning, and we say, you see, it's now frozen. You know, so when the body dies, it seems like our brain functioning is now stopped, frozen, fixated. No more fluidity to it, right? No more fluidity. It's concretized, reified, concretized. So, and then to make sure that evidence isn't tampered with and leaves a lasting impression upon us, we then invented decay. So it all decays away and we cannot revive it. You know, we don't want Jesus saying, Lazarus, get up from the grave, and Lazarus popping out of the grave. We say, no, Lazarus, you got to quickly decompose and rot away and into dust. And need decay, all right, to make sure that we don't change our mind and say, you know what, I don't want the body to be concretized like that. I'll have it be fluid again, you know. The body will just pop right back up functioning again. So we have death and then we have decay. Just that simple. Impermanence. Buddha's called it impermanence. All the stuff's impermanent. Well, of course, it's trying to hide the evidence. It's trying to destroy, present the evidence, then destroy it so it can't be changed. It can't be altered. You know, the dead body can't come to life again. It's all dust. That's why we have decay. So there's that. And a whole host of constant streams of just inspiration. But again, Facebook, I mean, what the heck? I mean, people are just grinding their gears superficially. They're not getting to their deeper habits. You have to look into the real deep habits of mind in order to really make any significant progress or headway. So anyone could just spin their wheels in the superficial part of the mind as we delay in hoping to have so much fun that insecurity somehow doesn't bother us anymore. Insecurity meaning that when you try to fixate the mind, you have to hallucinate the absence of God to even believe it's possible. And the problem is that hallucination is just the mind hallucinating, and the mind can just decide to not hallucinate, and then and instantaneously there's no more absence of God being hallucinated. So, of course, if you believe that your identity is based on the absence of God, which is a hallucination, you will feel totally insecure, won't you? Totally insecure. You think my identity is so insecure because the mind can stop at any instant. So what happens is you feel so insecure that you try to defend against that somehow. We do it by fun, distraction. Oh, I was having so much fun. We hope that that will cure our insecurities by distracting us from them. But they're still there. We're just so intent on having fun, we're not noticing them. And that's the modern agenda. Let's everybody have so much fun. And so people are trying to have fun, spiritual fun, fun like this. But fun is totally superficial. It doesn't do anything to remove those terrible habits of bias towards doubt that keeps, you know, we're so familiar with doubt, we're afraid to leave it behind, you know? We're afraid to leave it behind, and so we just keep going back to doubt, which necessitates hallucinating the absence of God, which makes us feel totally insecure, which drives us then to have more manic fun. So we're at this time now, last call at a bar, where everybody, you know, just thought they were all shipshape. You know, it's like, well, I've had enough for tonight. You know, I think I'm sober enough to drive now. And then, oh, last call, everybody. Ah, oh, maybe I better have one for the road, or maybe two or three, or a strong one. Give me a stiff drink, the bartender. And everybody falls back into patterns of severe doubt, persecuting certainty. So, out of self-preservation, you might say, I have dropped trying to predict too much, like pretending like I don't know what's going to happen. Well, sure, I know what's going to happen, but I've kind of buried it because people just hate that, you know, and it puts you in big, big trouble here. It antagonizes them. It's like a red rag to a bull. So you can't be certain, you're just lucky. That's what everybody said, man. And then they get real mad at you. It's like, well, you're just too lucky. That's not fair how lucky you are. You must be cheating somehow, you know. And it goes on and on and on. They just become very, very, very hostile when you start predicting stuff. So I'm sure I know what's going to happen. I just don't want to predict it. I don't need the aggravation. Holy Spirit tells me, yeah, it's coming. So, okay. But that's not my prediction. So we can practice wowing changes, future changes, changes that will be coming. Like, oh, an asteroid just hit the Earth. Wow. So you just say, but only evaluation, which is responses or evaluations, is only, we have an evaluation, then our emotion is how we represent that evaluation. But all the evaluation is wow. Let's say just wow. 360, just wow. Jesus has returned. Wow. We've gone to another world. Wow. See, so you can practice this three things like that. The future, practice the future right now. You can practice the future right now, meaning you're practicing your responses right now to what's going to happen, so that it's all already smoothed out. And the resistance, you won't panic. Because your thoughts are already, you've lost interest in all your thoughts concerning these issues. You lose all your interest in these issues. So asteroids hit the planet, no interest. Jesus has returned, no interest in evaluating. And going to another place, no interest in evaluating. Whatever happens, happens. But my mind is very calm. And we can even have the peace of God. So nothing disturbs us at all. Whatever happens, it's just a dream, actually. In the now. Okay. Nothing's really happening. But it just calms us down, so we're very, very clear-minded. So again, we can practice the future right now. And so I realized that precognition can be very helpful, because I could give you pointers about the future to practice right now. Right now. So I may revive my precognition in order to do this. If anyone actually does it, the only problem with YouTube, I never get any feedback. So I don't know if anyone's ever practiced one bit or not, actually. Not really. People are afraid to say they're practicing. I don't know what's wrong with people. You know, you say, hey, I'm practicing this. But the Holy Spirit wants it the way it is, so that's how it is, so that's fine. And, you know, asking a bunch of questions about practice is not really practicing. It's a way of avoiding it. It's superficial. If you're practicing it, you know you're practicing it. Okay, it's so simple. You just one evaluation for all evaluations. Wow, you just say, wow, is my evaluation. It's just that simple. And people are looking for too much, you know, reading. When they don't want to practice, they say, well, I would, but I don't understand the practice. Well, what do you mean? There's nothing to understand. Not really. It's so simple. One evaluation, just one. I have one evaluation for everything that arises in my experience. He goes, wow, that's it. And we practice this way to block panic, and it works. So if Jesus comes back, we say, wow, my evaluation of that. And so we practice ahead of time. We imagine, okay, Jesus come back, and what? Wow. That's it. Nothing else. Okay? Jesus has just taken us to another dwelling place. We left the world, gone to a better world. Okay? Wow. So we're in a better world now. Wow. Just like that. My evaluation of this better world is what? Is wow. So you see, you just stay calm. So you could literally go to another world, another realm, and you'd just be calm and relaxed and no panic in you whatsoever, because you already know what your evaluation is. It's wow. It's wow. It's wow. That's all it is. How about that? How about this fantastic application of the wow practice that just came to me today? So I tell you, a lot of stuff happens in my life, and it does. And I got the whole evening to go. I don't know what to do. I want to waste my time. I don't want to waste my time, you know, Facebook, and nobody pays any attention. I don't know. It's like you go down, it's like sort of a black hole. It's hard to, you know, people build up followings there. And, you know, I'd like to do that. I mean, I have so much helpful stuff to say to everyone. I know how to practice skillfully. I mean, what is better than that? Nothing is better than that in terms of anything short of a Dharma king. You know, to know how to practice skillfully like this and be creative, innovative, and helpful with it, that's as good as it gets. All this other stuff, it's superficial. I don't care. Like Ramana said, heart talk is just talk. It's superficial. He said practicing the inquiry is where it's at. And that's all he ever said. You got to do the practice. You're never going to get it if you don't do the practice. And then people just, so there's nothing about practicing on there, you know, on Facebook. It's like, what? And people are just, they just can't get past that barrier. I understand that. It's just how it is. They're deep. What it is they feel that there's no way they can get past those deep habits, that they're so ingrained, because we have believe that we've been able to automate everything. So they believe in automation is what they believe. And they believe those habits there are beyond, they're automated now, so they can't do anything about it. They need some intercession from something outside of the mind to stop it, which is they pray to God, hoping that God has got some intercede in it, you know. So they don't believe it's possible. So they don't even try. So they just stay on the surface and spit out quotes from, you know, all these spiritual teachers of the past and some of the present. And that's as far as they can go. But that leaves all the psychosis in place, actually. Their calm is superficial. If anything happens that they don't expect, then their expectations get ruffled, then the psychosis comes up and defends them, starts defending them in an illogical, absurdist way. and projection, blame, anger, fear, all this stuff arises. And of course, on our path, we're constantly going past our expectations because we know how to handle it. We evaluate the new landscape as well. We already know what the evaluation is. I don't, and no other evaluation. Don't even have to think about it. See, I don't even have to think about it. So I don't have to think about what my experience. I don't have to think about what my response or evaluation of it is. No thought is necessary. I know, already know it's wow. That's it. And you may be saying, hey, I think I'm getting it. Wow, that's tremendous. It's almost too good to be true, you know. It is, but it is true. Yeah, it's almost too good to be true, but it is true. And you have to, what's your evaluation of that? Wow. So your evaluation of hearing how great this wow practice is also wow. See, that's how you apply it. Say, okay, wow, that's my evaluation. I already know what my evaluation is. That one little step saying, I already know what my evaluation is going to be for everything I experience. For now, we're capping our expectations by doing this. That's as far as we want to go right now. So even the peace of God, our evaluation is wow. And this is what ultimately will result in abidance, ultimately. And whatever that arises, it, you know, arises, that's all. But we don't expect it, okay? Don't expect the peace of God. Cap expectations at, you will wow the peace of God. Okay, cap it there. Because definitely that will take the pressure off of you. And really, by willing to cap it and evaluate it just as wow, that actually induces the peace of God in your mind. It actually induces it. But don't ever make the peace of God a goal or a target. Okay? That will block you. It's too much pressure. Because that actually causes the mind to start thinking too much. Saying, well, if a piece of God, how will I evaluate that? I'm not sure I'm ready for it. I'm sure I don't have the right evaluation. I'm gonna lose it if I, you know. You're afraid you might lose it. So I gotta wait until I make sure I won't lose it, and then it doesn't come because you can't get it because you're still in evaluation. But if you say no, just one evaluation for the peace of God, then let it come. I'm ready. I'm ready right now. Just sit in this readiness, ready right now. Be quiet, be open, be empty, but say, I'm ready right now for whatever. Peace of God, go to another realm, end of the universe, whatever, it doesn't matter. I'll just say, wow. My revaluation of everything is just wow. So, I'm ready. This induces breakthroughs, spiritual breakthroughs. When you're ready, it induces them. Because your spirit will know that you're ready. It says, okay, I can wake up a little bit more right now. So this is being an apex wow yogin. Just practicing this way. And nothing else is. Nothing else is being an apex wow yogin except saying, I'm ready. I'm ready because I've committed. Apex wow yogin, it means you committed to one evaluation and no more than one. Just that evaluation. Wow. You could say I'm an apex eye yogin, like Ramana eye inquiry. We're saying, I say I'm an apex wow yogin. So both approaches like that is still an apex yogin, but we identify what kind of apex yogin we are by saying I'm an apex wow yogin. And someone else might say I'm an apex eye yogin. I say, oh yeah, okay. Welcome. Yeah, we're on the same page, aren't we? So no arguments or anything. Just, because you can really say anything at all. You could say I'm an apex, hey, yogin, you know. Hey is my one evaluation. Hey, or ah, I'm an apex ah yogin. So I'm an apex ah yogin. So that's fine. But profess that you're an apex yogin. You can say I'm an apex ah yogin, like ah. Just my evaluation, peace of God is ah. My evaluation of asteroids saving the world is ah. You know, whatever, right? I mean, wow is just as good a term as any, really. I don't see any better than that. It's a great term, really it is. Wow. Like, wow. I'm an apex wow yogin. But you see the ecumenical nature of it. There's no conflict. But start identifying yourself that way. This is super helpful to say, I am an apex whatever yogin, you know, fill in the blank, dot, 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 yogin. I'm an apex ah yogin. Ah. You say that, I'm apex. I'm an apex I-yogin. I. Or that. I said, I'm an apex of that yogin. That. I am that. You know, that sometimes is used. Has been used. Just that. So I'm an apex of that yogin. Okay, great. I'm an apex imaho yogin. It's similar to wow in Tibetan. I'm an apex imaho yogin. Imaho. See, you can do that too. So there's no conflict here. Okay, we're all on the same page. And then the practice is exactly the same. It's just the term we use is the only thing that's different. It's just a label. So we can have a coat of many colors here. All right. It's not a problem at all. As long as we absolutely understand this, that these are just labels that unique to our choosing, and the Holy Spirit, grace of God help us. But the practice is exactly the same, because we commit, it's commitment, the same commitment, just to one evaluation for whatever happens. And then we say, well, I'm ready right now then. Let the peace of God, whatever it wants to dawn upon me, let it dawn. Okay, I don't have to choose. I'm just going to, I'm ready for whatever. And then automatically your spirit will say, hey, hey, hey. I'd like to have the peace of God. Or I'd like to have this breakthrough. So I'm gonna have this experience because I'm ready. I'm ready for it. So this is what happens. So start to self-identify as an apex dot, dot, dot yogin. Dot, dot, dot. I'm an apex wow yogin. Wow. I'm an apex imaho yogin. Imaho. Like that. So I was, you know, just marveled, miraculously simple, we would say, miraculously simple. And so miraculously effective. But really, when you see it, you say, well, of course this will work. Of course it works. Yeah, I just was so addicted to doubt. No matter what I told myself, I just doubted it. So I couldn't see that it works. I mean, doubt just looks at fact and doubts it. You know? So doubt will just look at what works and doubt it. So we say, well, I doubt that works, so I'm not going to even try. This is the pestilence of this habit of doubt, is we could stare right at that which we need, and then we just doubt, well, I doubt that's what I need. Yeah, I doubt that'll work. And then ultimately you see, oh my God, it's so simple, it's so easy, of course it works. How could I ever thought it didn't work? Well, because we had this horrible habit of doubt. That's why. The horrible habit of doubt, and as Jesus tells us, we've spent eons and eons and eons trying to automate doubt, make it completely automatic outside the province of the mind, you know, outside the causation of the mind. We've tried to have an independent causation we call automation. Does it sound familiar? Automation, technology, automation. Come on, come on, connect the dots. And so it's so ingrained in us, doubt. When we see certainty, right away we doubt it. And doubt's an evaluation. I'm evaluating, that's not true. So our evaluation is just one wow. Is wow doubt? Well, wow is wow. Wow is wow. Imaho, how marvelous. You know, how marvelous. Is that doubt? No, it's how marvelous. See? It's a kind of a bridge. It's a bridge, isn't it? Because doubt causes the mind to be very active, thinking, judging, comparing, defending. Whereas if you just stick just one, there's no thinking, there's no judging, there's no comparing, there's no defending. It's just wow. It's just wow. That's all it is. The whole mind becomes, the whole mental chatter dies down, simplifies, dies down. The thought factory shuts down. We pull the main fuse, circuit breaker on the whole factory. Just wow. And so this is all just talking about my day here and sharing it as I'm called to do for sure. But, you know, Facebook is so frustrating. I'm trying to share on Facebook. It gets nowhere. I don't know if I should be trolling for more friends and that, you know, I And if you try to tell people there's something new under the sun, there's some folks, a lot of folks that just say, no, we already know it all. There's nothing new under the sun. We've been around for 6,000 years. And so there's nothing you can tell us, nothing new under the sun. And I say, wait a minute. That's not true. It's not true. This clarity here is very sparkling and brilliant of practice here. And even if it's not new, it absolutely deserves a new reiteration right now to re-emphasize this in a fresh way. And it's foolish to say, well, we've heard it all. There's some people who are on autopilot. They're automating their spiritual responses. But here, this is very fresh and from the heart. And I'm sure you can feel that. This is not rehearsed. It's spontaneous. It's just flowing. It's just flowing from the grace of God. That's all. So that is something new under the sun, actually. It's something fresh under the sun, at least, right? And you get these mindsets that are just stale and dusty, and they can't respond to it. It's astonishing. Thus, yeah. Everybody says, yeah, okay, I get it. If you got it, you do it. If you're not doing it, you don't get it. You don't get it. If you get it for 100% for sure, you're going to practice this way. No doubt about it. And again, you have the freedom to use any term you like here, okay? But apex yoga, I want you to use that term because that describes what you are, because you're practicing in the highest and most effective way. And you need to remind yourself of that and come out of the closet, come out of the spiritual closet and say, folks, I'm an apex wow yogin. Wow, which means I'm, the top yogin. I'm a top gun yogin. That is for sure. I'm dharmic, I'm very, very dharmic. Apex yogin is very dharmic. Top, that's the very top type of yogin. And if you hide it, then that's doubt. When you're practicing this way, I am an apex wow yogin. You're the top of the topper most in terms of spiritual practicers. So identify as that. Again, if you understand what's being talked about here, for 100% for sure, you're going to practice this way. Because you would see the miraculous effectiveness of it. There's no doubt about this. If you want to abide in the peace of God, this is the way to do so. And historically, this has been used from time immemorial to succeed. And the problem is doubt keeps forgetting it and keeps doubting it. So that's always the problem, isn't it? You could have the easy answer, which we do have here, and yet everybody in the world will just doubt it and they won't do it. So what, they just doubt, well, it can't be that easy, it can't be that simple. No way. Meaning, doubt has to have some validity to it. I mean, this is so simple that there's nothing to doubt. And so, no, I can't accept that. I got to believe that at least some of reality is in doubt, right? Some of certainty is in doubt. No, it's not. There's nothing in reality. Nothing at all. No aspect of certainty. Certainty is not in doubt in the slightest bit. Not in doubt in the slightest bit. So if you understand it, you will be doing this. You'll be an actual apex yogin. So if you come out and say, I'm an apex wow yogin, wow, that means you're actually practicing, which means you're at the you're in the highest echelon of yogins, which means you should feel confident about yourself and realize that you're very valuable. You're very valuable. You have a lot of value to be doing this because you're really helping free everyone ultimately from doubt, by setting the right example. So you're being super responsible, you're fulfilling your responsibility. You really are. So this creates this positive loop of validation. You're validating yourself. You're validating your value. You're a responsible citizen. Everything about you is right. It's trending in the right direction. I'm an apex wow yogin. Wow. So this is by invitation. I'm inviting everyone to join me and be an apex wow yogin. Apex dot 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 yogin dot dot dot, right? Again, you could say I'm an apex imaho yogin, imaho. And we can still talk with one another directly without any problem, okay? There's nothing in the way there. Nothing in the way. So, you know, completely ecumenical, completely open, completely fair, completely free, completely everything we want. And yet our habits of doubt cause us to doubt it. And we, you know, tearing our hair out, say, ah, I'm still, I know it's true, but I'm still doubting it, you know. Well, you don't have to get rid of doubt to do this. This whole practice is how to cap our expectations and getting rid of doubt so we don't have so much pressure so we can actually start working at it. Because if you keep trying to be enlightened, you won't get there that way. You just say, if enlightenment comes, fine. If it doesn't come, fine. My one evaluation of both enlightenment and non-enlightenment is just, wow. That's my one response to either one. Come what may, my response, my evaluation will be the same. And just take this attitude. This is straight from Padmasambhava, straight from the Dharma Kings. I have exactly the same evaluation of enlightenment and non-enlightenment. And let whatever comes, come. Whatever, and automatically, you know, naturally, will be, enlightenment will be more attractive to us. So that's what ultimately will arise. But we don't try to force it at all. Just be non-committal, say whatever. My just focus on what my evaluation is going to be, which is wow. Don't try to imagine what enlightenment is. Don't try to make it happen. Okay. Now this is the holy grail of practice. This is what all these posters are talking about. You know, they quote all these masters and say, don't try to seek enlightenment. But they don't know how to practice to actually allow this to happen, you know? They don't even know how to do it. So they're just, there's an abyss there. There's an abyss. Doubt is still very deeply in play. And what can I say? I see it. And what can I say? Really, it's so tough to, you know, work with doubt. They just, you get beat up by doubt. So all I can do is just invite. You know, I don't know how to get anyone to do it, but I know there is this practice, and I know this practice is effective. And so all I can do is just invite you, everyone, to just do it. And I just have to keep repeating myself. There's nothing else I can do. You know, I know you're suffering. I can't help you with your suffering, but there is a way that there is a practice that can free you from your suffering. And it is known here how to do that practice. So I just invite everyone to listen to this and hear it and just start doing it and identify as that. That's all. Someone asked me, are you playing golf this weekend? And I said, no, I don't think so, but because I'm through with golf in Northern California, you know, really, I want to play desert golf, you know, I just enjoy it way, way more than mountain golf, forest golf, mountain golf, hilly golf, I just don't like the golf courses here, I just don't like them. Once you've found something better, you know, man, you just say, hey, I don't want to. So it's just like once you find like A Course in Miracles, you're not going back to the Bible. You know, I mean, the Bible's great, but A Course in Miracles is you know, way better in a lot of ways, you know, way, way better. You just say, wow, this is a great improvement on Jesus. Jesus helping us out greatly here to go one God and no sacrifice. You know, that's better than one God, one sacrifice, which was really a great improvement over one God, many sacrifices. So the Bible was a huge improvement. The Old Testament was a huge improvement over many gods, many sacrifices. Jesus' sacrifice, the Bible, was a huge improvement over one God, many sacrifices. And then, of course, the miracles was a huge improvement over one God, one sacrifice. It's like that. So, you know, I'm ready for the next step. I'm an apex wow yogin, so I don't want to play on the old golf course. It's like I've sequentially gotten better. I started out on like municipal golf courses, dog tracks. You know, it's just and there were ratty and gopher holes everywhere. It was lousy, but I loved it. You know, because I started as a beginner, so it was great. But after I was more than just a beginner and really kind of had gotten a lot of more advancement and familiarity and all that kind of stuff, I started going to better courses. I said, hey, I should have been going to these courses all the time. I mean, holy cow, what was I doing on this municipal course? I mean, this is way, way better. So I traveled around and went to all sorts of different courses in Northern California and some in Southern California. And I was like, wow, this is amazing. This is great. I just love it. But then I got used to that. I found a home course that was really fabulous. I got used to that. But now I realize, hey, wait a minute. There's some even better courses that are way better than this. And I'm ready for them. I'm ready for like a private course. I want to play on a private golf course, actually. Private resort style golf course. Where there's very few people out. There's no pressure at all. And it's just a whole, you know, it's a whole different experience. It's much more peaceful. You know, you don't have pressure. People are behind you or waiting, people in front of you. You can just stop and smell the roses if you want. You can play anytime you want. You just walk on and play three holes if you want. You belong to the private golf course. You have to pay your dues, and you don't have any fees to pay. You just can say, I feel like playing right now. I say, sure, go right out. Get you right out. And you just go right out. I mean, that's what I'm ready for. I don't want to play. You know, I'm finished with the public courses and all the stuff you have to put up with there. I've been there and done that big time. So I'm ready for something way better than that. And so that's why I've worked for 2 years now to get in shape in my golf swing so I can justify it. Say, hey, I'm you know, I've got a swing. You know, I've got a swing. And I do have a swing right now. I have a fast, powerful, repeatable swing, and I have fitness, and I did the work. So that's analogous to being an Apex WOW Yogin. You know, you're in a different category. You know, quote unquote, you deserve to be on a super nice private course. You really deserve it. Anyone who professes to be an Apex WOW Yogin, wow, they deserve the very best. They deserve the very best. And that's how I feel about myself, because I have paid my dues. Totally paid my dues. I have truly paid my dues in this, whatever you want to call it, this struggle of doubt with doubt. And so I'm ready for something way better. So it's really cool to put those swings on there, the golf club, put those, that, like, wow, choke up, stand close to the ball, narrow stance, upright, see all this stuff, but greatly balanced, really a ton of balance, get the ball really in close to you, very vertical, very upright, and you just swing back, full swing back, bring it back inside, and then you just compact, whip that shoulder through, and then whip your wrist and sling it through, just like wham. And yeah, I can do it. I said, my God, where's that swing been all my life? Well, it's been hiding. I'd see it occasionally, then it would go into hiding. I doubt it. See it, doubt it. See it, doubt it. You know, I did like that. It's very frustrating. So I said, you know what? I'm going to get it permanently now. And to do that, you really have to have flexibility, balance, strength, and, you know, speed, all that stuff. Coordination. You have to have all those aspects. You have to be fit in both, you know, balance, strength, flexibility. And what's the other one? There's one other too, but those they all have to be there, and they all have to work together. They all have to work together. And then the final straw that put me over the top happened. And that was an innovation that I've never heard anyone do, and that's my grip innovation, where I leave off the right hand index finger and thumb. They don't even touch the golf club. They're not even involved in the swing at all. And this enables me to keep like this. I have it, you know, like that. My grip. They're not even touching the golf club. This enables me to. I don't twist the club. I don't twist a club. It comes through very, very straight. I can tell every swing it's straight, and this just gave me this massive confidence. Before, I'd be worried, like with a wedge, like, oh my gosh, what if the right hand comes in to try to scoop it? It's going to open up, and there, you know, you're going to shoot the ball to the right. With this grip, there's really no way I can even do that. I can't even do that. I can't open the club face, actually. As that's just boom, 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 every shot, you know, I know it's going to go straight. I know it's going to go straight. So that's just like a massive quantum leap, actually. So you put that, you know, you put it all together, all these facets together. And I say, you know, I deserve now, so a better golf experience. I really deserve it. All the facets of my game are really, you know, top notch at this point. So why should I go in some place where it's just, the experience gets ruined for you, you know, in all sorts of different ways. You know, no, I deserve better than that. So I just won't go. This is my attitude. Forget it. I'd rather not even play golf. That's my attitude. I'd rather not even play than play in some place that I feel is going to just pull me down. You know, and that's how I feel Apex Wild Yoga, and I feel I should be in a situation that, you know, supports this, that acknowledges acknowledgement of where I'm at. Same with golf. The golf course should be an acknowledgement of where you're at. It's an incentive to do all the work that I've done. I mean, I've been literally working out, dieting for almost 2 years, every day, just focusing on I'm going to get in great shape for golf. That's it. And do all this weight training and suffering terribly, can't sleep because my body's so sore. 2 years straight, not playing golf at all, basically, you know, just quitting, just to get in shape. You know, that is super commitment. So I feel, you know, I have aspired to a higher position, and now I deserve it. That's incentive-based society culture. I believe in incentive-based culture, where we have to pay the price to reach the goal. But when we do pay the price, we have a right to reach the goal. We have a right to reach it, to experience the fruit of our labors. Here we're not going in some quota, socialist quota system, where let's just redistribute all the fruits of everybody's labors to everybody, and if you don't have to, you know, you don't want to do any labor or aspire at all, that's fine. So the rewarding non-aspiration. Not incentivizing everybody, which is crazy, you know, it's absurd. But who? Because I guarantee you, people are not going to make the effort anymore. I'm sorry, they will not. I have been super incentivized. What happened was, I got this notice in the mail. I inquired about membership in a country club. Just like I said, I was told the Holy Spirit, one day you're going to be on a private course. And I said, well, okay, I trust you. So I inquired, how much is it? Now I got this information. I didn't have a penny, but I was just finding out, what is it about? I mean, what I want to get used to this. I want to start feeling like this is my goal. I want to incentivize myself. And then they said, come on down and we'll give you a tour of the place. And you have one round of golf on one of our private golf courses. And I said, holy cow. So I went down there just for that. And I got to play on this private golf course, which is one of the best in the world. And there was nobody else out there. There's like one other person or something. It was just absolutely life-changing for me. Because I just stopped. I walked off the tee. I walked off the green after I putted out. And I got in the cart. I was walking to the cart, I think. And I just looked around. And I just stopped dead in my tracks. And I just, it was absolutely peaceful and quiet and beautiful. Like there was nobody in the whole world. I was the only one in the whole world. And I was in some other realm, some other world. And I just stood there for like 10 minutes. I didn't move. And this huge stillness came upon me. And there's nobody on the course. There's no marshals. There's nobody telling you to, hey, move on. You know, most courses, there's marshals that are monitoring your place. Hey, hurry up. You're 10, you know, 10 minutes behind the ones in front of you. You know, there's no marshals out there. There's nobody checking on you. They totally trust you. You know, this is the thing about private country clubs. You're there because you have proven you're very, very independent and can self-governing, okay? There's nobody checking on you. You're their honored guest there, and you can do no wrong. So they're not. So they know you can handle yourself out there. And if someone came by, I'd just say, "Hey, how you doing?" They'd say, "Hey, wonderful." I'd say, "Hey, please play on through. I'm just kind of relaxing here for a while." And they'd say, "Great, man. Have a great round." And that's it. Everybody's very mature, you know, out there. They know how to handle themselves. So I had that experience, and one of the best experiences of my life, without any question about it. It never has left me. I just said, "Wow, this is where I want to be. This is what I want to aspire to. This is what I want to aspire to." So that incentive was there for me, and I've never stopped aspiring towards it. And it's been maybe like 12 years or more since that, maybe 12 years since that experience, something like that. And not a day goes by where I it doesn't motivate me and drive me. And I thought that playing on other courses up here would help me, but it didn't. It tore my confidence down. So I decided, let me do it a different way. Let me just absolutely groove my swing and my fitness and everything. So, you know, I just know it's not a problem. And so this is what I continue to do. So incentive, you see, I've incentivized my life. This is what I believe is required for all of us. We need to incentivize our life and aspire. Use that inspiration, aspiration. Say, I really am pushing myself to reach this really, really great goal. Pushing myself, really, really buckling down. You remove incentives from your life and you just turn into a, you know, let me watch football on television and guzzle beer and eat nachos this weekend, you know? You turn into a television watcher. I don't have time for TV. I want to get back on that golf course, you know? Watching TV is not going to help me get back on that golf course. I'll tell you that. So my character will help me, my fitness, my golf game, my spiritual character, my overall inner confidence, you know, all those things. I need to work on that stuff. Like I got to feel like I belong there. Like I really deserve this and belong there and know how to handle this and can wow it. You know, that's what I've been working on. So I got no time for movies and television, all this, you know, nonsense that everybody else does. I got no time for sports anymore. I got no time for anything except this. So that is, you know, incentive-driven life. And this is what the world is trying to take away from us right now. And what we're fighting back for. So, you know, I want an incentive-based life. Sure, I'm suffering because I'm deprived of what I want. But that just puts more fuel in me, more determination to work even harder. I said, I didn't get it today. Well, I'm going to have to work twice as hard tomorrow. That's my attitude. I said, well, I'm still not on that golf course. Why? So I said, why? What's wrong with me? What's holding me up? So I got to find out what's holding me up. And I'm really frustrated and determined. I said, I got to get this. Got to get it. How come I'm not where I want to be? And so it brings all of your attention to your mind and what's going on with you. What's going on? It's my fault. Okay, it's no one else's fault. It's for some reason I'm holding myself back. So it was a super blessing from God to show me that, give me that experience. I had another experience there where I went out Christmas Day. I believe it was the day before Christmas, and they had just opened the course up that day. It had been overseeded with rye for winter time, and it was completely pristine, that golf course. It was just completely surreal, and it was a sparkling sunny day, 24th of December, short sleeves, you know, shorts and short sleeve shirt on this absolutely pristine, beautiful golf course, and there's hardly anybody out, and that just flipped my mind. I mean, I said, holy cow, how fortunate I am. I've never even thought of anything this beautiful and so nice. It's just surreally beautiful. So that too incentivized me, said, you know, wow, I'd like to get back to that. And, you know, I'm pretty frustrated because it hasn't happened the way I wanted, as soon as I wanted to. So it just drives me all the more. And I won't stop, you know, even if I should happen to die, you know, I'm still saying, you know what, I want some really great peaceful experience. You know, I'm not going to stop until that. This is my life. You know, this is my life, is to be in such a peaceful setting where you can literally stop and smell the roses any instant you want to, and nobody's going to tell you that you shouldn't do so. Okay, that you're so trusted, nobody's pushing you to do anything when you're out there. It's you're out there just because you choose to be there, and nobody's going to say, well, shouldn't you be doing something different? See, nobody's going to say that to you. They're saying you're out here because you're doing what you love to do. So there's no question about, hey, shouldn't you be doing something different? That doesn't exist. It doesn't exist. You see how wonderful that experience is? See, that's the great thing about playing golf on a place like that. You know they're out there. Whoever was out there is there because they love it. That they're there because that's what they want to be doing. They love it. So you don't ask them, why are you here? Like, hey, you know, baby, don't you think you're doing something else? No, it doesn't arise. You just kind of smile and nod and just say, wow, isn't this great? Isn't this great? Yeah. Like minds. So, there's such a big cultural battle going on about all this stuff. Versus certainty is the whole battle. There are those of us who want to battle our way into certainty, right? And we're willing to pay the price. And we want to be incentivized. And we're willing to pay the price, even though it may be tough. And there are those who just want to try to have fun, stay with doubt, and they don't believe it's possible, and they just want to have fun. And they think everybody should have equal fun, and incentives aren't fair to them because they're not willing to pay the price. They claim it's not fair. They're being victimized by this incentive-based culture. This is nonsense. They're just lazy. They don't want to, you know, they just are so arrogant. They think that they've automated doubt, and there's nothing they can do about it. That's called arrogance. So they should have to pay the price for their arrogance. You know, not us paying the price for our repentance and our willing to pay the price and struggle to, you know, accept incentives. Why should we have to pay the price for those who are so arrogant they insist that it's impossible? You know, that doubt is automatic and there's nothing they can do about it. That's arrogance. They're trying to be greater than God. Why should we have to pay the price for that? Those who want an incentive-based culture. We should not have to pay the price. And I say, if this world goes towards just, you know, no incentive at all, then those who want an incentive-based culture will go to some other realm. We'll go to some other realm. I'm not going to stay here. Because that other way is just hell. It's just hell. And I know what it's like. Sex, drugs, rock and roll, and football on weekends. And more drugs. And you see these people in America all the time that are so obese. It's just insane. Everywhere. I mean, what you look, you say, well, what's this? What's this? A circus is in town or something? And then you look over there, there's another one. So, wow. I mean, yeah, the circus must be in town. Because they have no incentive in their life. So they might as well just eat. If you think that you can't do it, you're just going to eat. And I was through that summer of 2015. I felt, you know what? It just. I think it might be just too difficult for me to do what Jesus wants me to do. So I said, what the heck? I'll just start eating. That's what I did. Whatever I want to eat, I ate. No limits to anything. I think tonight I'm gonna just eat like 10 Snickers bars and, you know, chocolate ice cream with whipped cream and pizza and, you know, whatever I want. You know, it was fun for a while until the results of that started showing up. Then I said, this isn't going to end well. And then I made a decision that, you know what, it may be tough, but I'm going to go for it anyway, because I believe that I know it's doable, so I can't be a liar and a hypocrite and give up, because if it's doable, what am I doing giving up? I'm obligated to make my best effort. then that was the beginning, you know, that was the turnaround. Still not on that golf course, though. But I keep trying. I keep trying. And I would love to invite Apex Yogins, those who say, I am an Apex WOW Yogin, wow. I would love to invite them to come to such a golf course, a private course, you know, and hang out for a while. Absolutely, I would. Because you deserve it. You absolutely deserve it. Anyone who makes that profession because they're practicing because they've seen it and they know without a doubt this works. To understand it means to practice because you see for sure it works. And it would be completely absurd not to practice in this way. So anyone who does that, they deserve incentives. They deserve to experience incentives in their life. They absolutely deserve it because they're incentive driven. So I'm an incentive-driven spirit, very much so. I've been willing to make contact with the Dharma Kings because that's powerful incentive, extremely powerful incentive. You meet Sri Sri Anandamayi, you never forget it. The incentive is burning in you, you know, just, oh my gosh, I got to see her again. It's like meeting the best friend you could ever possibly have. The perfect friend. And meeting Sri Sri Anandamayi is like meeting the perfect friend. And then somehow your attention is away and she's gone. And you say, what the heck? You know, we say, wait a minute. I know a perfect friend exists, so I gotta find her again. You know? Like that's what it feels like. I mean, just imagine that feeling of meeting the perfect friend, which is what she is. You can't even describe it, can you? But then to lose it, wow, that will incentivize you, won't it? I know you're somewhere. So I just went cuckoo for a while. I gotta find her. Where is my friend? And so I keep trying. I keep trying. This place is playing hard to get, or I'm playing hard to get. I think I'm the one who's playing hard to get. You know, trying to play both sides. Like, yeah, perfect friend is great, but you know, how about these over here? You know, maybe I can incentivize them for sex, drugs, and rock and roll or something through great music. You know, music is a way to incentivize the superficial. So we have more fun. You know, all women are sex goddesses, basically, you know, concubines. And all men are what do you call it? Call them. There's some word for it. Bon vivants or something, right? Bon vivants. Fornicators, bon vivants. And so everybody has this wonderful floating depravity going on, which was the sort of the 60s in a lot of ways, 70s, 80s, 90s, 2000s. Right? It's been getting worse and worse. Someone told me something really funny today in San Jose, California. Here, there was this nightclub, and it was right next to this Comic-Con convention or something that was going on, some, you know, geek convention. And this nightclub was kind of like a Tex-Mex kind of nightclub or something. And so there was all these Hispanics, and they were all totally duded out in cowboy wear, real fancy, you know, dressing. They got all the embroidery on their jeans and everywhere. I mean, those cowboys, those Hispanic cowboys, man, they can really dude it up, you know, really dress it up. They look real slick. And they're, you know, saying, hey, gals, look at me, man. I am sweet, you know. And then what happened was, The guys from the Comic-Con, these geeks who are all dressed up like Pokemon, they came out of the nightclub too to have some drinks and mingle. And so you had these mingling of these Hispanic cowboys, duded up cowboys, with these geeks dressed up as Pokemon, you know, in all their comic book character outfits they're wearing. And he said, like, the cowboys are, like, looking, like, they saw, like, walking, one of these geeks would walk by, and the cowboys just, like, looking, like, what the heck are you, you know? Could you get that mental image of these two facets of culture mingling in a bar? That's what happened here in San Jose. That is hilarious. I mean, some of these tech geeks, I mean, they are just, you know, in woo-woo land, you know, but God bless them, you know, it's just that's their expression. But the juxtaposition with these cowboys, I know the cowboy look. I mean, these guys, man, I mean, they're you know, they're just slick. They're on the prowl, you know. And these two, oh man, that just is. I you know, you gotta have some pictures of that. You gotta throw some pictures on Facebook, some of the pictures of that, because man, the expression is just like juxtaposition. Holy cow. Where am I? Did I just go down the rabbit hole here? So there you go. Modern culture, huh? You gotta just vomit, basically. So, you know, we want a spiritually incentivized culture here. Period. 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 I won't settle for anything less. If I have to go to another realm, I will go to another realm to have that. And just the fact I'm aware of other realms, it was a huge incentive. I have been taken to other realms in spirit. My awareness has been taken to other realms. I know about these realms, and they're way better than this realm. Okay, they're like a beautiful, gorgeous private golf course compared to a real dog track, overcrowded, junky, 6-hour round municipal course or something. You just like you hate it. You say, "Oh my God, why am I playing here?" Of course, if you're a beginner, you think it's great, but if you're really at very advanced, you say, "I forget it, man. This isn't my place." So, this world is like that terrible kind of ratty, unkept, bouncy, green golf course that just is terrible. And people are hitting you with golf balls, and nobody knows the etiquette, and everyone's drunk and everything. It's horrible, horrible experience. Okay, well, our world is like that, and then these other realms are like this pristine, beautiful, gorgeous private golf course where no one knows you're totally trustworthy. There's no hurry, no pushing. You could spend all day just sitting in one place if you want to. No one will say a word to you. You can even stay all night out there. No one will say a word to you. Nobody expects you, tells you what to do. Totally free to do whatever you want to do. It's so beautiful. It's so peaceful. These other realms are like that. So, you know, you talk about incentivizing. I want to go to those realms. I've been invited to one of those realms. I was invited, directly invited. It was a Dharma king that invited me. And he said, "Would you like to come visit my place?" I said, "Yes, I would." He said, "Great. Let's make it happen." I said, "Wow. Where is it?" He said, "It was right next door. It's easy to get to. Just go through this gate. You're there. Just go through this gate. Tathagata, the gate or something, right?" Those who want to believe in the doubt, they're trying to automate doubt, that once they do it, that they won't have insecurity anymore. They incentivize their delay tactics, which is all it is, with sex, drugs, and rock and roll. Everybody, let's have a big orgy, you know? And so they keep trying to, you know, incentivize that. They want everybody to be more and more beautiful, more and more sexy, more and more. And they use music, entertainment to try and do that. Absolutely, they do. You know, they listen to some singer like Elvis, and the women are just like, "Oh my God, Elvis, you know, I just feel like totally amorous. You know, my level of amorousness has just gone, you know, 1,000 times what it was before." That's what they try to do. You try to incentivize amorousness through popular culture. That's what they do. That's what they do. I realized that. I said, "Oh my God, that is true. It's very true. So what the heck am I doing singing? Doing singing?" That just is incenting amorousness, you know. It really is. I saw that and I said, "Oh yeah." I'm trying to do both ways. You're like, well, if one doesn't work, then I'll have the other one. You know, if getting on that great golf course doesn't work, I'll always be able, be I'll be able to be a really good singer, you know, and incentivize amorousness. You know, the fun culture, which runs on amorousness, really. You know, look how sexy I am. Look how incredibly sexy I am and attractive the body is. You know, both genders. Of course, women are way better at it than men. They tend to be more committed to that. You know, it's like this. They really, really can just, you know, constantly, like, they're like birds. You know, their costumes and everything, the way the makeup and everything. Holy cow! But guys are getting more and more into it also. don't know, maybe is that why I've been practicing singing? Maybe. Yeah, I said, like, you know, that's very, very possible. I'm trying to, like, have both options available. These one doesn't work. I said, well, I'm waiting for that golf course, man. But this, I've been waiting a long time. I think I deserve it. I believe I deserve it now. I really deserve it. So, you know, get me that. Otherwise, I may have to start singing. Because I need something to do, you know. I need my future, so to speak. I need my now. You know, I need my now. What am I going to do? And what's my experiencing now? What, you know, am I just going to sit like a statue? Or am I going to be interacting? Or what's going on with my now? Come on. I want to know. I want my now. I want to be experiencing it. And long as we, you know, we have to cap our expectations to some extent here, you know, with our practicing, and therefore we're going to still be experiencing a world and bodies and thing and doing stuff. So I don't know what I'm going to do. I don't know. I don't want to drive around California looking at wildflowers. I've been there and done that. And you know, it's. There's a lot of people doing it, driving around. It's a hassle driving long distances, you know. It's tough. You have to day trip it for the most part. I've been there, I've done that, and I've seen California at its best, and right now it's at its best again. But I just don't feel like doing it for some reason. Otherwise, this weekend I'd probably do it because it's at its peak right now. You know, just wildflowers, carpets everywhere. But I said, yeah. What I'm going to do, I'm going to take pictures, I'm going to go there, I'm going to take some, ooh, so nice, take pictures. No, I want something better. I want to be on the outdoors. I want something better. I want something better. I want a total immersive lifestyle right now. I want to be immersed in another lifestyle where it's slow paced and I can count on it. It's not some long trip, you get up early in the morning, drive like all these maniac drivers. Anywhere you go in California, the whole thing is ruined by these maniac drivers. These lunatics, they're out to kill people on the road, really. It scares people. I've been scared. I don't want to go on trips anymore. You get people going 130 miles an hour, weaving through traffic. You get people doing every manner of unsafe driving now. They just are freaking out. Obviously, their minds are imploding. So you can't just cruise and relax. It used to be drive through California was such a wonderful thing to do. Everybody was so civil and polite, and you go 55 or 65. I enjoyed the 55 speed limit. That was amazing. Can you imagine that? There's people seeing it used to be 55 in California with the gas crisis. How awesome is that? Wow, I'd love to go back to that. And you were just looking. You could look at stuff and say, oh, look at that. That's so beautiful, beautiful. Nobody was pushing you. Now, everybody's like a demon. They're dancing with the devil. Seriously, it's that bad here. I'm not exaggerating. You just feel like I kind of just like a gesture, are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? You can't let me in. You're going to cause me to crash, just so you can squeeze me and keep anyone from getting in front of you because I have to merge. I mean, that's what the way people are. I mean, I'm not trying to get ahead of you. We're supposed to zipper in, right? I mean, you can see that there's road work up here and everyone has to merge and you have to squeeze me. So, you know, I have to like slam on the brakes to avoid an accident. I mean, it happens constantly. That's no fun. I'm sick and tired of it. I'm ready to go to another realm right now or an immersive environment of a private golf course. I'm ready for it. Gated, private golf course where I can drive my golf cart around for transportation. I am sick of driving. It's become a torture now here in the Bay Area, and it's getting way worse all the time. 85,000 units are being added just in one neighborhood. It's already gridlocked there, and they're adding 85,000 units and 1.7 cars per household. What is that, 150,000 Kodu cars or something? Something, you know, about that, right? Yeah, sure, let's just add 150,000 more cars to an area that's already gridlocked where they get two people through every traffic light. And that's a great idea with no public transportation really at all here. Yeah, that's just, you know, brilliant. And of course, Google's solution is, hey, everybody, just ride your bikes. Yeah, we got it all figured out. We're like tech people. We're smart. Just hey, everybody ride their bikes. Yeah, we don't have a problem here. You sure? We just, you know, got 85,000 new units and maybe 200,000. 50,000 new people in your neighborhood, but if we all just ride bikes, you know, to work and back from work, and that'll solve everybody's problem, right? But I think they want to implode everything just so everybody will ride bikes. No. Can people, you know, guess what? People use their vehicles for their work, right? Not everybody works at Google. I'm sorry to say, blood burst your bubble, but guess what? Some people have other jobs and they need stuff in their car. You know, bike isn't going to work. How about this? You like heliport these people in from the Central Valley or something. Pay for it. Or put them on a houseboats out in the Bay Area, a bay or something. And why don't you build a subway, Google, you know? Build a subway. You know, these tech companies are the ones that are bringing all these people in. And they're expecting the taxpayers to build subways and stuff. No, let them pay. Or why don't they build their headquarters somewhere else? Instead of ruining our quality of life here. Go up to, you know, Montana, which they're doing, Billings. There's tech hubs all over the world now. Go to some other tech hub and have workers live up there instead of ruining our culture here, which is what they've done. They've ruined our culture. But thanks, because I'll find a better realm than this world. Better place, better realm. God willing, I put my eggs in that basket, really. Because I can't sing good enough to you know, be in the next Elvis. If I was 20, I could, for sure. If I was 20, with the talent, skill I have right now, you know, I could be the next Elvis times 10. But I'm not. I'd be way better than Elvis. Because I had the young voice and the young strength and everything. The stamina and all that stuff. I would just knock everybody out vocally, just knock them out. And the women would all be swooning and you know, they'd be taken off their clothes like they do at, you know, concerts and just, you know, behaving like maniacs. I mean, that's what happens at these rock and roll concerts. Women just start stripping, you know. They're like going to a frenzy. They go into a frenzy. That's the point of it. That's the point of the whole thing. Everyone's on drugs, you know, and just trying to go into a frenzy of, let's see if we can forget about our insecurity, the insecurity of hallucination. Forget about it. It's still there. You know, the insecurity doesn't go anywhere. It's inherently insecure. Yeah, but thank God that didn't happen. Thank God I'm not banking on that in 20 again, because I would be a hellraiser for sure vocally. I would just do it all, that is for sure. But not at my age. The vocal cords are not as resilient, so I can't hit the high notes. And the falsetto, the real super high stuff, it's erratic. I can't hit it every time. And I get my voice, a lot of singing, it goes flat. It doesn't bounce back so fast. But when you're, yeah, you know, it would be bouncing back like this. And I'd be going from the high, and I know how to do the low. I would be soaring everywhere and just ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba in the groove, dancing in the groove, just absolutely grooving it. And just, you know, wow. People would just say, holy cow, we can have fun with this. This sounds like fun. So I'm capable of being fun, you know, but that's the devil's work. That's the devil's work, actually. That's how I see it. That's how I've seen it now. It's like, wow. Not good at all. I'd rather experience the stillness, you know, and just the trust where no one asks me, What are you doing? It's just, I am, nobody, it never arises in my mind. I just, you know, when inspiration strikes, that's what you're doing. I don't have to take a picture. I don't need to sing a song. Nobody's expecting anything out of me. So I'm expecting, you know, that kind of immersive. I want an immersive experience is what I want. 360-degree immersive experience where I don't have to worry about any of the stuff that we call worldly stuff. I don't want to worry about it anymore. So that's what I want. That's, you know, way better than being a rock star. I was a wannabe rock star when I was young, but God protected me from succeeding. For one, I didn't sing. I refused to sing. Thank God. I had this fear that if I start singing, I'm going to ruin my life. And then somehow, maybe the ego got me to finally start singing. Like Elvis, I said, oh my God, I can sing. Like, I was really scared. I said, I don't want anybody to hear me. And so I really had to hide my talents because, you know, especially if women hear you, they say, oh my God, you know, come on, sing for us, play for us. We love it. Let's dance. We want to dance. You know, they become very aggressive, very, very aggressive. Super dangerous thing. Because they think, you know, having fun, they think, well, we're not fun enough, but you make us feel like fun. You know, we're not sluttish enough, but you make me feel like a slut. You know, that's what they're like. They're desperate. You know, I feel beautiful when I hear your music. You know, I want to be beautiful, and I want to just dance with abandon. You know, I want to be this whore. You know, I just feel so whorish. You know, but fun whore. I'm a fun whore, and like that. And I just want to take drugs, and I just want to let myself go, and I just want to, you know, hey, welcome to the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, and 2000s, and the 2010s, right? Yeah, before that, well, they had nightclubs, you know, we used to have something called prohibition in this country. So people said, well, that's no fun, you know, because we had the flapper era and the jazz era. The jazz girls were like just trying to have as much fun as they possibly could, you know. And then prohibition, I said, hey, we got to shut this down. Religion said, no, this is the wrong way. So we had prohibition, and then the people, you know, eventually they repealed prohibition. Everybody's started having fun ever since then. It's one of the worst things that ever happened in this country, repealing prohibition. Along with just, you know, everything else that's happened since then. Just nonstop decay, yeah, absolute decay. So you don't want to be having that kind of fun. You want to feel like you can just be immersed in the peace of God. Wow, I'm an apex wow yogin. Wow. Okay, so incentive. I would love to incentivize your life. You know, I would love for God to incentivize your life. I would love for you to be incentivized, spiritually incentivized, towards, yes, I can get past this doubt and experience the peace of God and abide in the peace of God. Yes, I can. I can be a saint. Yes, I can be a saint. When I was young, people asked me, what are you going to be? I said, I'm going to be a saint. That was my goal in life. They thought I was crazy. What are you talking about? I said, no. You have to be, if you incentivize yourself properly, you will be a saint. A saint is someone who's abiding in the peace of God. So I said, absolutely, I'm going to do this. But you know, you can't tell people that, but I tried to. I'm just honest. I said, I'm honest. Honestly, this is what I'm going to do. Believe me, I will do it. Because I will insist on being incentivized properly. So you can be a saint. Anyone can. If they incentivize themselves properly, then they just work and work and work and work and go for it, right? So, and there are those who, of course, are trying to do both, and I have to, like, weed those out. You know, it's a dangerous thing, because I could go either way, but actually I can't really go the other way. I'm too old. You can still play golf when you're 60. You can't be a rock star when you're 60. Sorry. Not really. The whole thing about rock stars is excess, right? I mean, we're having so much fun, we're killing ourselves. That's what the culture loves. Look at these people. They're self-destructive. Wonderful. Hey, he OD'd on heroin. Oh, what a hero. You know, yeah, they love their rock stars dead, don't they? That's what they want. And I'm not into that. I'm into feeling great all the time. I'm not into excess at all. I'm not into that. I'm not into dying. I'm not into destroying my life at all. So I can't really be a rock star. Sorry, gals. It's not going to happen. Guys and gals, but the gals really, they're the ones that really pick up on that. They're the engine that drives fun, you know. The party gals are what drives the whole fun culture. Without that, you know, it's not as fun. Really, it's not. You get one party gal and a group of guys, and everybody perks up, and the whole thing is seems fire is fun. Ah, the whole idea of fun suddenly is there. But then, no party gal. And the guys are like, ah, I don't know. What do we do? I don't know. Watch football again? Ah, not so fun. So it's the party girls that drive the whole fun culture, and they want those musicians to play a tune. Dear Mr. Fantasy, play us all a tune, something that'll make us happy. You are the one that knows how, knows how to, what is it? Play a tune, make it snappy, Dear Mr. Fantasy by Traffic. That's what it's all about. Dear Mr. Fantasy, play us all a tune. That's the fun culture. The boomer, baby boomer, started the fun culture. But before, there were the flappers in the jazz age. And throughout history, there have been always been these generations that said, you know what, we're here to have fun, and that's the answer. And then there are others who say, no, we want to be incentivized to the peace of God. And that's always been this dichotomy in the world, right? This tension in the world, and you can feel the tension in the world right now, very, very severe. So, words of wisdom. I am an apex wow yogin. Okay, and a practiced one. Not just a complete novice. I'm a practiced apex wow yogin. So I can speak words of wisdom like this and share it and, hope that it's resonating with some out there. It's really resonating. And maybe it will. You don't play golf to have be part of fun culture, okay? You play golf to be part of dignified culture of this peaceful, non-expectation, trustworthy, self-governing, responsible culture that everyone trusts one another there, and they don't need to police one another, and they don't no expectations what you're supposed to be doing, and it's beautiful, and it's quiet, and it's slow-paced. That's a spiritual type of culture, really. I mean, that's very dharmic. That's what you do. That's what you're aiming for in golf. You're getting away from the world. You're aiming to get away from the world, and you're believing, you know what? I want to prepare for a better experience in this world. I want to prepare for that. I'm tired of the world. I'm tired of the rat race, and Silicon Valley is one of the worst rat races in the world right now, and I've been living in the heart of it my whole life, and it's lousy. It's no quality of life here. They're all after fun and money, They want to. They're after money so they can have fun for the rest of their lives. That's all that is going on here. There's no culture here. There's no spiritual culture in the Bay Area really at all. Actually, it's about money. To get as filthy rich as they can, as fast as they can, so they can spend the rest of their life having a whole bunch as much fun as they possibly can. That's it. That's as far as their mind goes. They're just totally superficial here. Just extremely superficial spirits here. Who wants to hang around that? I don't. I don't. So, but it's up to God. I do the work. God laid the incentive down. I say, okay, God, I do. I'll do the work. And the rest is up to God. I like it to like a marriage. Jesus likened to it to a marriage, where it's like I feel like the Dharma kings have been like my suitors, saying like, we really, really want you to choose us, to commit to us. And I've been playing hard to get, apparently. And today I finally said, I do, I do. Okay, it's like a marriage. You say, I do. So the rest of stuff is is off the plate. Stop playing hard to get. I was trying to play hard to get to see if I get a better offer somewhere else, right? But I said, I do, I do. So now it's honeymoon time. What experience are they going to give me? I say, so there, I can commit to them. It's like a marriage. When you get married, you say, okay, wow, let's celebrate, in a beautiful, beautiful place. Let's set the spiritual tone, okay, for our partnership together here. What's our purpose here? What's our purpose in life? So what's the Dharmaking purpose? Is it not what I've just described in this video of the peace of God? And it's not, is it not incentivizing the peace of God and bringing us to that? Yes, it is. So what's the honeymoon? What's the, what, how am I, you know, what, they're going to treat me to this honeymoon. So what's the honeymoon going to be like? I don't know, you know, well, I'll find out. You got to say, I do. You have to commit, 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 commit. Don't play hard to get. So that's the only thing I can figure out. I've been playing hard to get. But I still enjoy singing. I enjoy singing just because it's, I feel very free. I can express it any which way I want to. I'm working on Dion. Trying to harmonize with him is very difficult. Especially Donna, the prima donna. That, because he sings it so perfect, I have a real hard time singing it differently. But I'm getting there. I work at it all over and over and over and over. Like, and you know, gradually build up confidence so that then you can just like go on all this counterpoint and sing all this different counterpoint but make it all sound great. But that's a super, super tough thing to do on that song because he just belts it so perfectly. I end up singing along exactly how he sings because I think that's the best way to sing it. So I've been practicing to sing it differently than that. So you could just sing as a hobby just because it's like a hummingbird. You could just go any which direction you want to. So it's a way to be a little bit creative. But you cannot use it to introduce fun to people. That's then you're doing the devil's dance. There could be some other ways to when people are really down to, but what are you inspiring them back to? I don't know. It depends how creative it is. Is it fun? You know, there could be some spiritual ways to sing, maybe. I don't know. Music tends for me to inspire the superficial, you know, incentivize the superficial. It really does. Historically, looking at it, that's been my history. It's been my experience. You get all these people who think you're the most wonderful person in the world. Why? Because you make them their life to go, I can always listen to some beautiful music. I don't have to dig into my mind and doubt and do all the tough work, the tough, really tough work to break those deep, deep bad habits of doubt. I can always put on some beautiful music and that's good enough for me. That's how they use it. That's how they use it. Now, I could do both. I could have beautiful music and do the tough work. But not many people seem to be able to do that. And there's a time when you have to drop music and get down, discipline yourself so you have the work ethic. And then ultimately you can go back to music and enjoy singing or something if you want to, I guess. I'm not positive about that. Maybe I should stop singing, but it helps me get rid of stress. This traffic that I'm spending all day driving in this traffic, I just sing. Sometimes I sing as loud as I can. I got my blast back, voice back, which I've been missing for a long time. Finally let it out and just full blast, like an air horn, it's so loud. And I can sing like that really well. I can shift vocal levels now really well. Yeah, but nobody can hear me. And also I'm jiving I sing better when I'm jiving, like moving around. It gives better inflection to your singing. People say, what's that crazy guy doing? He's But I said, I don't care. I mean, what else am I going to do? Tear my hair out because some me-obsessed person, you know, thinks that losing one traffic space is the end of the world for them? And they'd rather have me die than lose that one traffic space? I mean, I might as well just sing. It makes the day go by better, that's for sure. But I also have tremendous spiritual focus, so it's like that. I don't want to teach people to sing because that, who knows what they're trying to incentivize, right? They may be trying to incentivize fun for themselves. Most people are here. Most people don't believe they can be liberated and be saints. Most don't. So they're going to try to and have fun. That's what most people say. Most people, 99.99% of the world are that way. So, you know, if you really want to sing, you're going to show you how to sing. You're going to show you how to sing. I get these tips from the Holy Spirit. I say, oh, like that. Yeah, I can do it like that. Now take a break. Yeah. But no, I'm not going to train anybody. And even in yoga, Apex yoga, training meditation, so some people just use it as a stress reducer so they can have more fun. Or some way of liberating some energy, kundalini energy, so they can feel more lively and have more fun. That's what how they look at it. They're not doing it for the gifts of God. So I don't teach meditation. I don't teach this stuff. I'm just here as an example, incentivizing you, basically. But it's so simple. If you understand it, you will do it. That's how simple it is. If you understand it, you will do it. And if you don't understand it, it's because of doubt. And there's nothing I can do about that. You have to work with the Holy Spirit directly. I can't help you. Not like that. So I'm just kind of saying, hey, I'm an Apex WOW Yogan. Wow. Letting you know that you can do this too if you want to. But, you know, I can't teach you how to do it. Teach you how to sing either. It has to come from the heart. You know, how to do it comes from your own heart. Your own determination will show you how to do it. And you will have that determination if you're properly incentivized. So I just act as an incentive. That's all I'm really doing, just as incentive. But then if you're to really feel it, you will do it. You will do it. I absolutely know this is true. So it's a different way of looking at the whole landscape, right? And this is what I'm comfortable with. So that's where I'm at. How are we doing here? Well, we laid down another great video, didn't we? Hopefully you've been able to watch this one because it's really flowing. The whole thing, just 2 hours of complete flow here. And obviously I'm feeling pretty chipper, pretty good. In spite of a 2.5 pound burrito I ate at that birthday party. I mean, the burrito, like I said, you could do curls with it, and I gained 2.5 pounds. I got on the scale this morning, I gained 2.5 pounds just from that burrito, because it had to weigh, you know, three or four pounds. I mean, yeah. I'm not eating anymore. I'm eating liquid food from now on. I'm not eating solid food anymore, actually. Very little. I'm sick and tired of solid food. It's not me. I don't like it. It makes me feel dead, sluggish. I felt lousy this morning, sluggish. It's just dead. It's all this death you're putting in yourself. I just like drinking fruit juice. I got fresh squeezed orange juice again today. I just come and make a smoothie with fresh squeezed orange juice, tart cherry juice, green power drink of algae and spirulina and kale and all this green good goodness, broccoli green goodness drink, and chocolate protein powder and some frozen blueberries, and that's my food. That's my food. Yeah, and then I'll have peanut butter on something, like maybe a piece of toast with peanut butter, or marmalade, or honey, and then nuts. My finger food is just pecans and walnuts. I had some pistachios today too, and for my bread I'll have cashew butter. Almond butter is really good. I love almond butter now. The first time I tried it, it's great. Peanut butter, sunflower seed butter, sesame seed butter. I put different nut spreads or seed nut, you know, sunflower seeds, call it a nut. But I put these different nut spreads on a piece of sprouted wheat grain bread, 7 Ezekiel bread. It's really good. You get in the freezer section. It's sprouted grain. They don't use flour. They use sprouted grains. It's really, really, really good bread. It's the best bread I've ever had. You just put Ezekiel, it's called. You put that, just some butter and... By the way, I'm a vegan except for butter right now. But you know what? I don't want to be a vegan. I don't want to say, hey, I'm a vegan, everybody. But I am, except for butter. I like butter. So I guess I'm not a vegan. They'll say, oh, no, you're not a vegan. You're using butter. Oh, well, yeah, I'm not into being like a dogmatist, you know. It's okay. But other than that, I'm not even eating yogurt anymore. Or hardly any cheese at all, really at all. Just no dairy products except butter. And other than that, I'm a vegan. Fruit juice. Oh, sorry, the whey protein powder. Uh-oh. There you go. Anyway, I'm happy with where I'm at. And I feel healthy. I feel incentivized, you know, and confident and optimistic. But at the same time, it's like, get me out of this Sodom and Gomorrah hell here of the Silicon Valley, the rat race, you know, of money and fun place. You know, no, 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 no. I want to stop and smell the roses. I want to be immersed in that. I want a honeymoon, you know, with the Dharma Kings. Of, you know, I'm an apex wow yogin. Wow, that's big time. That's big time. That's what they're aiming for. I mean, it's a lifetime of work to get to here. A lifetime of the most brutal, difficult work imaginable. Beyond imagination is so difficult. So this is a big deal. To get to be an apex wow yogin, that is a really big deal. I mean, that's what, you know, that's their goal for us. Their goal, once we're in apex wild yoga, the peace of God is going to dawn upon us, and we're going to abide in it. It's guaranteed. It is, they guaranteed it, longevity, but guaranteed it in my case. So this is a huge deal. So, hey, like I said, I want a nice golf course. I deserve it, and I'm ready. So we'll see what the Dharma Kings do. It should be very interesting for all of you that are following along with this. You know, what happens with Clarity Ross? I mean, what happens with this apex yogin? What's the honeymoon going to be like? Inquiring minds want to know. Yeah. It's going to be, I already know what it's going to be like. Wow is what it's going to be like. Right? I already know the future. Future is wow. And that's it. Wow.